dear fellow believers, grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior. Amen. Got a question for you, those of you who are out of high school, maybe for more than a couple of years, and you know, lived in different places. You can raise your hands on this. How many of you ever rode a school bus? Oh, there's a few of you. Do you remember the days when you started as a little kid and you'd sit down there and you'd watch the older kids and they go to the back and then they go to the back and then they go to the back and you're going, someday that's going to be me. I'm going to ride in the back of the school bus. Do you remember how much fun it was riding in the back of the school bus? Bouncing up and down? My senior year, Mark and I decided we didn't want to do that anymore. And yes, I rode the school bus my senior year because my dad used to say, hey, I've already paid for a ride for you. You don't have to drive. Isn't that nice? No, it's not. But we decided, rather than bounce along in the back of the school bus, we're going to move up front where it's a little smoother. Because you remember, school buses didn't have much for suspensions, did they? And our bus driver, and I love his name, Leonard Smutzer. Just rolls off the tongue. Leonard says, no, Mike, you and Mark sit in the back and you watch the bus. So we had to spend the whole year in the back doing that. We wanted to sit up front, not in the place of honor where the older kids got to sit. So the first day we allowed the little kids to move back, boy, they were excited. Then we had to go back. We're filled with expectations like that. Where we're going to sit, what we're going to do, how we're going to live. But we're always concerned about ourselves, consumed about what am I going to get out of this? And we're always looking for the best possible angle in life. 3 years ago, I guess it is, we took Chris over to Iowa City to start school at Iowa. He was staying at Mayflower Lodge. Or Mayflower Hall. Looks more like a lodge. And we go through the room like he's going to have, and it's kind of nice. It's a quad, two guys here in the kitchenette, and in the bathroom in between. And we tour through there, and oh, that's kind of nice. And then we've been in the hallway, and the person doing the tour says, do you have any questions? This one lady raised her arm, and she said, yes. Is there a maid service for the kids? You know how hard it is not to laugh to the person next to you asking that question. Obviously, this was her first child away from home. And the woman, young woman doing the tour was very professional. She says, no. Your daughter's an adult. We would anticipate she'd be able to care for herself. The little girl, the young woman, just looks so disappointed. Nobody can take care of her. Who's going to take care of me? I need help. I'm more important than anybody else. When Jesus gets to this point in his ministry, he's moving in and out of the community. He's spending some time with the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and those types of people as they intersect in what he's doing and where they're going. And today he intersects with somebody who everybody would assume is a Pharisee. He's got it. And Jesus intercepts with them, and what he finds out is he hasn't got it. That's not because he's a Pharisee. It's because of the way we are as human beings. We're turned in on ourselves. And so Jesus is going to eat with him. And it's an opportunity for Jesus to open up the new kingdom of God to him and speak to him in ways that he'll understand, but ways that really push him as well. And Jesus is pushing all the folks there out of their comfort zone, away from thinking that God is going to be bound by the rules that God establishes for you, that you do not work on the Sabbath. And Jesus says, wait a second, you do some of these things. If you have an ox that falls down into a well, won't you pull him out? If you have a child in need on the Sabbath, won't you take care of him? You are God's children, he says. God will take care of you on the Sabbath. And the day before, and the day after. And every day in between. And he told them that story not too much long ago, and they still have forgotten about it. And he comes into the Pharisee's house to eat with him, to dine with him. And we see this. He comes and sits at the table. Well, you know how they sat back then, don't you? On big cushions. They lounged on the ground. They didn't have tables because wood's a premium in an Arab country. So you would lounge, you would sit. And Jesus watched as everybody came in and took the nice pillows, so to speak. And he understood human nature always wants to care for itself first. And Jesus is inviting you into the new kingdom in which God cares for you first. And he's trying to bend that thought and that mindset back toward God and off of ourselves. You know what they say? A person wrapped up in themselves makes for one small package. Jesus is trying to tear open humanity so that it looks around and sees what God is up to. And today, what is God up to? But inviting all into his presence. Everybody. The ancient tradition of Israel, which is carried through by many into this day, is that at every evening meal, the place of honor is set. The place setting is there with the flatware and the plates and the cups and the chair. And they have their meal for their prayer for the meal, and they wait to see if the Messiah is going to come and sit among them at the place of honor. And Jesus is reminding us is that when we rush in and sit at the place of honor, God's not going to come in and push you off the chair. It's just not going to come in. What Jesus is inviting his disciples and the Pharisees and everybody gathered there to see is that you cannot overstep God. And you have to know a couple of things about meals given in that day and age. When a Pharisee had a meal, who was invited? Whole community. Sure, there were some special invitations that went out to certain people, but then once the doors came open, everybody in town could come. And if you had somebody new in the community, everybody in the town wanted to see them and would come. And so it's not a surprise that the poor and the lame and the broken would see him there as well. What Jesus wanted you to see in this story, this parable, is that when they come in, by the one who said, welcome. What Jesus is talking about today is reframing our world. Moving from seeing us in control to allowing God to be in control. As a child, when I was growing up and we got into our new house, my dad's place was always on the north end of the dining room table, and you could see all the way down into the living room. And he sat there every night. And before we would say our evening prayer and have our meal, he would look up. And if the lights were on in the other end of the house or the TV was running, he'd go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We're all here. So why is the TV and the light on? If nobody's watching the TV, it ought to be turned off. If nobody's down there who needs light, it should have been shut off. Mike, go shut off the TV and the light, because I'm opposite him. I'm going, wait a second, I can leave it on. My dad's next question was, did I ask you? My dad didn't have the seat of honor, he had the seat where he was in control of things. But I always grew up thinking, you remember the text, we shall sit at God's right hand. My uncle moved from Minnesota down to North Carolina to work down there when he quit farming. I got his place, which was right to my grandfather's right hand. I walked in awe of my grandfather. And I used to think, after hearing that text, that is pretty good for me. And I used to think about that. My dad was on my grandpa's right hand. And I used to think, what did my dad do that my grandpa put him over there? And I spent my entire life thinking that, wow, I'm on the right, my dad's on the left. And one day as I was in my mid-teens, my uncle was home for a few weeks in the summer, and he sat down where I was, and I had shifted down one, still on the right-hand side, though. And there it was. My uncle's left-handed. He couldn't sit on the other side. I was not in a place of honor. I was merely at a place. What God is saying to us today is, hey, there's no need to buck yourselves up. God is going to take care of things. And you're all invited into the next kingdom. Whether you're lame, blind, in your brokenness, God says, come. And because we're all broken, we all take a place lower, so that when the Messiah comes again, he can go, hey, guys, up here.